Ladies and gentlemen, welcome on the Watch Your Mouth podcast again. Our guest today is Jan Hellinga from Omeo Group, and he's also a mentor for Start Life, Start Hub. Every Wednesday, he's available in Wageningen at the Start Hub. And I'm very happy to have you here on the show.
So am I.
So, welcome.
Thank you.
We had some conversations before, and you mentioned that you were also a student in Wageningen.
That's true, yeah. It's a long time ago, but yes, yeah. I was a student as well. Yeah.
Were you also born and raised in Wageningen?
No, I was born in Amsterdam.
Okay.
I lived there until my 10th.
Yeah.
Then we moved to Hilversum in the Netherlands. And from Hilversum, I started my study after secondary school. I started the study at the Agricultural High School in Dronten, which is a more practice education.
I also studied there.
Okay, nice.
Say aha.
For me it was HLS, HLS.
Okay.
Yeah. And from there I had a teacher, Mr. Nijwening, who was always very enthusiastic about plant protection and plant protection, the science behind plant protection. And he brought me his enthusiasm to be excited about this part of study. So I came to Wageningen to study plant protection, which is doesn't exist anymore. It's part of plant science now, I think. I studied plant protection, crop protection. Yeah, that's right.
Cool.
In Wageningen.
And did you grow up in a farmer family?
No, not at all. In Dronten at the HLS, they mentioned me asfaltboer, which is an asphalt farmer, because I came from a big city, and so my father was worked in gardens, and that's all. But we lived in an apartment in Amsterdam, and so nothing to do with farms actually. No.
Interesting, many people from Amsterdam, for example, one of my other guests on the show, Gijs Spoor, who lives now in India, in Oroville, he's also from Amsterdam, and he also happened to be a student of Wageningen, and then agriculture is like takes over the city people's mind and imagination, I guess.
And it makes the circle around, because now you have your urban farming, right?
So
the farm is going to the city nowadays. Yeah, that's right.
But now your profession is slightly in a different angle.
On one hand yes, on the other hand no. My business now, I have my own company, Omeo Group, business coaching, and we give coaching and training to people based on our experience and the things we learned, and that is, for me, it's focused on sales training and coaching, teamwork and negotiation with other people, communication with other people, which is pretty different indeed. But on the other hand, most of my clients are somewhere in agriculture or are doing in the in agriculture actually.
Okay, it's interesting that because I've seen that you also finished in Wageningen, and I've seen on your CV, on your LinkedIn a bit, like also in your introduction as a mentor of Start Life, that you were working in the agriculture on in the field for like almost 10 years, and then you shifted somewhere to around sales and marketing for more than 15 years. And in the last 10 years you are into the coaching, mentoring.
That's right. After my study, I first went out of the country for 2.5 years. I worked in Yemen in plant protection, in plant crop breeding. I worked there for a seed potato company and producing potatoes for the local farmers to seed potatoes for the local farmers to grow their potatoes. When I came back, I was a teacher for 1 year at a secondary agricultural school. And then I started working for the plant protection company here in the Netherlands, plant protection service. So still in agriculture and in plant protection, and I did that for almost 5 years. And then one of the people working in the field for the plant protection service decided to start his own company in field research. And because he thought that companies, chemical companies, might be interested to have a private company doing the field services, the field research. And he asked me to join him, so I started with that. And in fact, that was my start of commercial, being in the commercial part of doing business. And I was, let's say, a technical sales manager there, so technical part, because it was a small company, but also the sales part. And I developed all the contacts with new companies and so on and so on. And in that sense, we grow from 4 people to 15 people at the end. And not only working in the Netherlands, but all over Europe by doing residue trials all over Europe, and which was a very exciting period, actually.
Nice. And how did you train yourself? Because nowadays it's very, when someone has a background, it's very difficult to shift to a different area, like from very technical to sales. I understand that you had this advantage that you were part of this company from the beginning. But still, how did you train yourself to become a very good negotiator? Is it all came naturally, or
In fact, it was naturally. I mean, I think you need certain personal skills to be a good to do the sales in a proper way, and that is having interest in other people and why they do as they do and how they do it and so on. So that is something natural behavior, so to say. And on the other end, by doing it, getting experience. And because when I started with this company, it was technical as well as sales, and that, so I had the contact with the people about the technical part, but also about new projects and so on and so on. So it's a kind of slipping into it, more or less, and so I learned that. And when I worked for that company about 5 years, then there was this other company in Sertogenbosch where we worked together on residue trials. They did the analysis of the crop parts, and we did the field part. And then the managing director of that company asked me to join them as their commercial manager, and so then I moved a bit away from agriculture into sales, and because they did not only do crop protection products in the analysis, but also health products and industrial chemicals. So in that way I grew into another area indeed. I had to learn myself how pharmaceutical companies deal with those things, and industrial chemical companies, and so it was more or less a growing into this field.
And I guess they also had a budget or a bigger budget for marketing.
Much bigger. The company was tenfold of the smaller field company. So when I started, there was about 85 people, and I've been working there for 12 years, I think. When I left, it was about 250 people. So more and more money to spend more on marketing and things like that.
And your professional work based on human behavior from that point. Was that also based on just your experience, or you went into like more studies and about behavior and marketing, or where?
Again, it's both, I think. So it's experience, but I don't know when, even before I started here in Wageningen, I was interested in psychology and behavior of people. So I read a lot of books about that, and I read books of Freud and Jung and those things, and the Dutch psychologist, psychoanalyst. So it was also a real interest of natural interest, and so that that was maybe the basis of what I'm doing now, indeed, in on human behavior. And
Because what I'm saying is that these are so deep topics that if you are in a very competitive position, maybe you don't have time to research and go and do the basics, what you already had maybe throughout your upbringing and other, I don't know how long did it take you to go through all of the literature as a passion on the side.
Yeah, well, like I said, I the passion was there already when I started studying here. And indeed I had, I mean, like I said before, this guy, this teacher at the Hogelandbeschool, he developed the interest for me for plant protection and plants and so on. But nevertheless, I always had the interest also in people. And why are you doing the things you're doing? Yeah. And why are you doing it in this way and somebody else exactly the same thing doing it in another way? Mm. And those questions always slipped through my mind, so to say. And so the interest was there, but I didn't study psychology because my idea always from a young boy on was I wanted to see the world, I wanted to go abroad and so on and so on. And then for me there were only two choices, and it was doing something in health, medicine, or something in agriculture. So I chose for agriculture and went out of the country, indeed.
For how long were you abroad?
2.5 years. Okay. I've been in Yemen for 2.5 years then. And there was after that there was the opportunity to go to some other countries, Algeria and Costa Rica, but both were not successful in finally getting a contract for that. And because the one, they didn't have the money, and the other one, Algeria in that time was pretty dangerous to go to. And so I had a wife and a first child, and so we took the decision not to accept that contract, actually.
And what made you shift from sales and marketing to coaching?
I think that has something to do with age. At some point in your life, at least for me, you think that, okay, I learned so much, I had so much luck, and I had a good job and all those things, and then there comes a time that that you want to help other people, younger people, to improve their life, to improve the company they started, to improve their skills and so on and so on. I mean, it starts of course with your children. You want to learn them to be ready to go into the big world and so on. And that was for me coming back also to my passion about how people deal with things and how they behave and so on. And so that was for me also the good reason, the total to go into an own company and doing this. And there were some other things that I worked at TNO at that moment, and there was a big change. TNO, the business unit I worked in, together with the management team, we have developed that into a private company. And then I could say, okay, I go into start working as a director of sales and marketing in that company to develop that again to a bigger company. But I had done that before already with the company in Zetelkombos. So I thought, okay, that's the same trick doing again. Is that nice? Well, maybe not. Maybe it's a good time to change to something completely different. That's a quote. And at the same time, my children, they finished their study, they had a good job and so on. So I didn't feel so much responsible anymore for the children. So there was a good time to decide to do something really different. And then I thought, okay, I like to do this, helping other people.
And it's like also a more entrepreneurial path this way.
It certainly is, and that is something that always went through my mind for a long time already, that sometime I wanted to start an own company and do my own thing and decide which way to go myself, and so on and so on. Yeah, so this was a good moment to do that. And so I started in 2010. Yeah, it's about 10 years ago. Yeah.
And how do you see the world has changed since 2010? Because since 2010, the internet boom has happened with the social media got popular and used by everyone, almost every age group. And also it affects the marketing, the coaching, the entrepreneurial world, the startup world.
Yeah.
A couple of years ago, when I started my internship here at Start Life, there was a new thing, almost a startup, and there was not even literature, that was not in the culture. How do you see it, how it has changed in the last 10 years, or maybe in the last 5 years?
Yeah, well, quite a big indeed. Like you're saying, the whole digital evolution makes a big difference. That nowadays there's a lot of learning through internet. Just follow some courses on internet, answer questions through internet, and so on and so on. And that has changed a lot. And we have. We as Omeo Group, we have adopted that also, and we give also training that we do a lot of the theory through internet, and we come together to practice those things. And that, so that is really a difference. In the past we gave trainings of 3 days or 6 days or whatsoever, and now it's only three times half a day, because the people they learn from the internet, and we check that by asking them questions and so on. But we practice it in the half day workshops we do, and which then is really a workshop indeed, and not so much about theory.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Cool. And have you also experienced that the sales, I guess the basic patterns are the same, like supply and demand and the basic psychology, in general, how the methodology of sales shifted from physical sales to digital sales and e-commerce?
What I noticed that the differences, the differences between sales and marketing is less and less. It's more marketing and sales is becoming one job, actually, one kind of way of selling your products and or your services. So that is a difference with the past. I think you had two different departments, marketing department and sales department, and that is becoming together more and more. That's one thing. And the other thing, you can do a lot of digital things, but people have to they need to want to give you something. So you need to you are their favorite to give something, for instance an order or something like that. So it's always, for me, it's always necessary to have personal contact with the people that buy from you as well. And yes, you can do a lot of communication, marketing communication or other communication through the internet with WhatsApp and all those things, and pictures on Instagram and LinkedIn, and that is important indeed, but at the end it's always that people have to grant you an order, and therefore you need personal contact. Maybe it might be old fashioned, and nowadays salespeople say different, but that is my feeling. Yeah.
I think you are right, because if it's only on the internet, I mean, the internet is also so noisy. There's so much stuff is coming. People, at one point, they just I don't want to look at the screen anymore. The other new magic product which will solve all of my problems.
Mm-hmm. I fully agree, like I said, people have to grant you, and it's the same as with you. If you go to a shop and the guy is not nice or the lady is not nice to you, then you go to another shop and buy it over there, because the people are more nice to you, and that is all everywhere the same. And I truly believe in that the personal contact makes a good sales, and
so we can say that also average people base their decisions on feelings, right?
Yeah,
And also many entrepreneurs, they say that they just follow their gut or gut feelings.
Yeah.
What is your experience with that? First, can you reflect back on your own decisions? Was there any example when you were thinking, it's not entirely logical, but you followed your gut or some other feeling took over you?
Well, I always work with DISC, D-I-S-C. That is about human behavior, and that is a model that already was developed somewhere in the early 90s. That says something about preferable behavior of people. I myself, I have in the DISC, I have a high I. That means that I'm outgoing, I'm direct, but I'm focusing on relations. So for me, most of my decisions are based on gut feeling, and my gut feeling is also very well developed, of course, because of that. And I realize that other people much more decide based on facts and figures and so on. So that is what I use in my selling myself, myself as a consultant, but also learn other people how to work with DISC and how to do that. Now I wonder if I answer your question.
That was your own experience.
Maybe
you can also, because you work with many entrepreneurs, maybe you have a general overview where people tend to listen, whether is it they stick in their head and their brain and they just cannot figure out the right answer because just so much variables everywhere. Because you just cannot figure it out, or there is a tendency that they somehow, I don't know, it's through the DISC model or some other methodology that they listen to their guts or other feelings. So that's,
well, I think people can learn that, but if you are really in the DISC model, you are a high D or a high C, it's very difficult to even hear your gut feelings.
For the listeners, the D is
the dominant people, so they are the people that are direct and result oriented, and the C people are indirect and result oriented.
Yeah.
So they're not on the relation side. They are more on the facts, on the results,
analytical.
And they may have gut feelings, but maybe they don't hear it very well, and then it's difficult to listen to it, of course. And if you don't hear anything, you can't listen to it. So I think that is the main difference in it.
Because that's what I'm also like experimenting with, and have sometimes struggle with it, and try to explain why am I doing what I'm doing, and.
Yeah. Well, that's what I see a lot. I'm as you know, I'm coaching a lot of startups here as well, and helping them. And what you see a lot of people here in Wageningen with a startup, that they are scientists. They come from the science and want to start their own company. And a lot of them, they have difficulties in going with the product to the market because they think it's not good enough yet. Mm. So I have to develop and recalculate and develop and recalculate and so on until it's really good to go to the market. And that I think is a mistake because, you know about the lean startup, go as soon as possible. Once you have a kind of model, go to the people that are intended to use it. And then discuss with them what whether it's good enough or not.
There is also a business coach quote that perfection equals paralysis.
Exactly. That's for sure. So that's some of the things I discuss with people when they come here on a Wednesday afternoon to discuss with one of the experts, including me, about questions about the company, how to develop, how to continue, and so on, how to make it successful.
And how do you see that, for example, when someone has a very technical education and technical background, and they see that there is maybe a solution, a technical solution, and they go for it, but sometimes it's not aligned with their, so they have like the question from the university and from the world that, oh, this is a problem, and they see that okay, this could be the solution, but sometimes it's just not aligned with their personality to push it through,
mm-hmm.
because they don't believe in that much, or they see more the technical side. Because that's the other thing, is that I don't know if it's entirely true or not. Some of these, I think from Stanford, one of these business coach guy explained that entrepreneurship is the closest to being an artist.
Mm-hmm.
So the artists are also operating with feelings and emotions, and entrepreneurs too. And if you just have it from a technical angle, you enter this world from a technical angle, maybe you cannot navigate yourself in a way how it would be the most beneficial. I'm just,
yeah,
maybe it's too complicated question.
No. I understand what you mean, but I think everybody could learn at least a bit about that, and and I understand that if you have a small company, you are a startup, and you are technical, really technical. You want to improve your product and so on, like we just discussed. Then still, if you come to coaches or ask people about this, then I think if by talking about it, you can also get some skills, learn skills to even then start buying. Once you can understand that you're a bit stuck in your technical side, and you're willing to learn, then you can also learn to get some skills to do selling, and maybe not perfect, and you won't be the best salesman there was ever. But nevertheless, you can learn some skills, because if you're a startup, there is no money to get a good salesman so you have to do it on your own, and that is what I'm training people how to do that. Even if you're not a real salesman person, then how can you do some sales, and that is how I can help. And once the income is growing, you can hire real salespeople and go back to your technical part, of course. And but I disagree in saying this, that those people are not capable in doing their sales. I mean, that's the only possibility they have. Otherwise, or they have to. You have to ask somebody to join your company, become a shareholder, or I don't know what, if you don't have the money. So these are the solutions. But I'm sure that people can do something about it, and if they're willing to learn a bit about it, accept that there are possibilities to do sales, be it not the most perfect one, but having the possibility, then I'm sure they can learn something about it. Yeah.
But it's not just about the sales, but also the whole human game behind being an entrepreneur. Because
I agree.
Also,
and because the next step is, once you go into form a team, are you a good manager for a team, or are you do you just leave the people doing their job and no bordering? I mean, a manager of a company or of a team, for me it's always, it's the captain of the crew, but the father of the family, and so you need both skills. And on those people that I think are not able to do that, don't have the skills to do it, I advise them to find somebody who can do it for them. So you can have your own company, but then you need somebody who is doing the let's say the personal side, the people side of the company, and mostly that is also a good combination with sales, actually, because it's all has to do with relation with other people.
And for me, coming from Hungary, the Netherlands seemed much more entrepreneurial, of course, than Hungary. But when I looked into the literature, like 5 years ago, it said that, oh, the Netherlands is not that entrepreneurial yet. That's in the culture, that it's a shame to fail. But I've already seen many Zzzpayers, how do you call it in
English? Yes, Zzzpayers.
like private one-man's companies. So I already have seen them years ago that, oh, there are much more entrepreneurial people here than in Hungary, for example. But how do you see how it's shifted since the startup as a new buzz came in? Is there more willingness to try out entrepreneurship or to start a new company?
I think that's a difficult question if you combine it with a startup. I mean, in general, you can say in the Netherlands, in general, I think there are maybe 800,000-900,000 one-person companies nowadays. And that was also a kind of push because we had this crisis in starting in 2008 or something. And people were fired because there was no work for the company and so on. And they decided to start their own, their one-man company. And they are, not all of them are successful enough. Some live on a very basic income and so on. But there is a lot of them that are successful. And so there's entrepreneurship in a lot of people, but they need a trigger to develop that and to use that to get an income. And I think so. There was a big change indeed. And ever since 2008, the number of people having their own company, the one-person companies, is growing and growing all the time.
Okay, so the entire culture is changing and it's getting more admitted that, okay, there are people who don't want to take a job or cannot take a job, and they go and try to find their own path.
And if you compare it with the university, it's different because the people there, they're not because they want a job, it's because they have an idea and they want to develop that idea in the way they think it's the best way, and that is why they start their own company then.
But you mentioned something about the StartHub. It's not getting that popular yet, the entrepreneurship, or what was the direction where you wanted
to go? No, the difference with the startup is because there are a lot of people from the university or a higher education that do it because they have an idea. And that is what I meant.
But it's still agriculture and food most of the time is still very capital intensive to start with.
That's true. And that is also a difference, of course. And if you you work in building, house building or whatsoever, you don't only need some tools and then you can do the work, and which is not so very doesn't need much investment or whatsoever. That's right.
And how do you see the self-help movement or industry? You know, there are in the last 10 years. Tons of books and courses and coaches and self-made entrepreneurs and like a little bit yourself with the company, but there are many variations about the books and methods and all of this. How do you see this world is emerging? Does it really help? Or because sometimes there is just so much information that for me it's very hard to filter.
Well, the it's a big advantage that also for my work I can learn a lot from internet. There is so much on internet to see. What you do need then is the expertise you do need something to decide whether something is correct information and which not, which is fake and so on and so on. So that becomes more and more difficult, of course. But nevertheless, there is so much information on internet available, and that is a change as well. You asked earlier about the change between 10 years ago and now in training and coaching. That it's not necessary to learn the people the theory behind things because that's on internet and when I look at my business coaching, actually to simplify it very much, I can say I do read all the books for the people and just give them the summary in my trainings. And so that is what my value is that I take the time to read the books, and they don't need that time to take the time. So There is a lot to learn, you call it self-help, about books and about from internet and so on. But I'm coming back to what I said, like what the salesman, you need contact with other people, you need to practice, you need to practice in with other people, and I'm convinced that you can't do without that. And you can do a lot with books and self-help, but it's always you're not the only one in the world, and you need to cooperate with people, you need to deal with people, you need to communicate with people, and that is an important thing, I think.
But the wave and the movement, or I'm also like kind of doubting how to call it, because it's a kind of movement too.
Yeah.
But it's also an industry where huge companies and coaching companies and mentoring companies grew up, and they sell courses and so it's just also very hard to find a way, because some also the pricing, what I also felt is kind of tricky, that they put a huge price they said the requirements. And there is also a possibility that they just give some general training, what you can also read or you have already read, but somehow you still fail with the execution. And then they offer you to help, but at the same time, the responsibility is still on the person. I'm not talking about in general, because of course the coaching companies have their valid role, and also especially what you say, that personal contact and all of these very important aspects, but some coaches are so overpriced that you really think that there is a huge value in it. But you never know.
You never know. You have to try, and then you know it, or ask other people, ask references, and I think that is a way to understand it. I also look from the other side as a salesman. If a buyer is willing to pay a high price, I mean, you can sell a product for the price from the cost from the product, but you can also sell it for the price that the other is willing to give for it. That also has to do with questions from the market. If the market needs a lot, then the price is high and has to do with that as well, I think. So you can say that some consultant companies, they are very expensive. But that's also because people want to pay for it.
Maybe they take their own actions more serious if they pay the high price of it. It's also a kind of commitment for themselves.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
It's just the tricky part is that it's another business quote. The most of these bigger actions, what an entrepreneur take or starter or startup, is from inspiration or desperation. If they are in the flow and everything goes well, and they can hire a coach or pay for a huge coaching session for 1 week or whatever, then it goes, and the whole flow is gonna be nice. But if they are desperate, and they are hoping to have a flip in their personality and their change, and the session wouldn't allow it, this highly priced, what I mean, then they are even more deep in trouble.
That's true. I think it is like that, but it's of course the quality of the coach or the trainer to turn that and to make it in every training in a positive outcome, and at least give the other one the good feeling after the training that he really learned something,
like
about
empowering
right? It's a good word for that. And that's of course the quality of the trainer and the coach.
Yeah, cool. And we talked a lot about there is a lot of noise on the internet, and we try to keep up, but also we have to filter a lot. And my question is also related to the human behavior, that nowadays it's coming up a lot that some kind of meditation or some kind of practice is needed to keep the mental freshness or the stability. What is your opinion on that? Or do you practice anything? It doesn't have to be like a very zen wall-facing meditation, what I mean, but nowadays they also say that a meditation can be running or gardening. How do you see it on your clients and on your own example?
Yeah, well, part of our way of training and coaching is NLP, neuro-linguistic programming. And that has something to do with the mind, and it's too much to explain it here, but anyway, that has to do with let's say kind of meditation about the brains, how they work, and how you can change things in that. That is one part, and the other part, and I mean, I'm not that young anymore, so I can compare with the past, so to say. I think it is just like you said. You can call it meditation, but you can also do some running, and that's what people did in the past as well. They didn't call it meditation then, but that is what they did. You can running, you can go walking. I myself, every year I go, I walk the Vierdaagse in Nijmegen. Before the time, you need practicing, and that is walking for 20 or 30 kilometers a day. But people can do gardening, they can do whatever, and the intention is still the same, and the way it's expressed is different. You have your boot camps nowadays. People go out in the park and do a boot camp, and or people do running or whatever, but the intention is all the same, and that is a kind of meditation, a kind of relaxing the whole body, including the mind, just like that, relaxing.
What do you see is the most popular? Is there any new trend is coming up? What people tend to practice?
I could say ice baths, what is popular? I think the boot camps is at this moment is really popular. The sun's touch, the weather is becoming good again, and now people go out, and running is of all times, I think. And people, you see, if the weather is okay, you see people running. But special trends, I don't know.
And what is your choice of meditation?
My choice is the walking. So that's one, and I play basketball as well. So once in the week I play basketball. So that is my way, and then I can really forget everything, and when I have a bad day, I'm really thinking, oh yes, tonight I'm gonna play basketball, or tomorrow I'm gonna have a long walk, I can really look forward to that then.
And how long is the walk?
The walk is it's growing now again, because the how do you call it, the March of the World is in July, and so I'm now up to 20 kilometers walking, something like that. So it's 4 or 5 hours.
Nice.
It is.
Nice.
And
how do you see what is missing, or what would be nice as a new trend, or what is the common problem what startups face with?
Those are difficult questions. What I see a lot of times is that startups, but that's a part of the total. The startups they start with one or two or three people or something like that, and they become a group, and they a lot of times I see that the after a certain after a period of time, maybe 1 year, 1.5, 2 years, the problem starts, because one of the person wants to go this way and the other wants to go that way. And I always advise them, start immediately, start on an early phase. Where do you see your company in 5 years? How do you want to develop in the future? Do you want to become a big Unilever or Frieson Campino whatsoever, or do you want to stay kind of in developing, in innovation, in research and things like that? And you see a lot of split ups or even stopping their company because they didn't discuss that in early phases. And so it appears that one wants to go to earn a lot of money, become rich, and another one wants to continue in developing new things in innovation and so on and so on. And the third one wants to help people or something like that. So, so and it is really important when you have a company, once you people are going to join your company, to discuss that from the beginning on. And that is really one of the things I've seen so many times that it's the company stopped.
So you would advise a vision quest for startup founders?
Yeah, definitely.
And how would it look like? Or they would go for a walk for 20 kilometers and just
there is also indeed a branch of walking coaching or something like that. I don't know how to call it. But indeed, yeah, you can go out for a walk, but you can also say, okay, let's sit together every month or on a Friday afternoon with a drink and discuss how our company has to develop. And then you can learn from each other which way you actually want to go. Because in the beginning, it's you start idealistic, nice, and or start at the bar. Oh, let's start a company, right?
Yeah.
We have a good idea. Let's start a company, and your friends, and so on and so on. But that develops, and once you people see that, oh, you can earn money from it as well, and then maybe one of the the two or three or whatever says, okay, I want to earn money, that makes my life easy. And but another says, no, I want to further develop it and so on, or I want to improve the world or whatsoever, and make life better for people. And it's completely different at the end.
Yeah.
And I really advise just go sit together for a couple of hours every month or something.
So this is on a group level,
for
me, and on an individual level, what you see is missing most common from someone who wants to do something, but you know, to form a company, it's challenging. They say it's one of the most challenging adventures nowadays too.
It is. Well, what I see there is that it is difficult to stay focused. People need because it's they don't have really other people to decide to go this way or that way. So they take every chance to earn some money and continue with that, and so going to left and to right and so on and so on. And the focus is for a startup is really important. And I understand the difficulty in that, because you need to earn money, of course. So if people are asking you something which is not really in your scope or in your focus you have of the company, then you are going to accept it because it brings you money. And that makes it really difficult to stay focused.
These low hanging fruits. And what is there any methodology, or I don't know, what is the best way to filter these offers? Because it's a tricky part, like when you are surviving but also you want to grow.
No, I think the only model is have the guts to take risks. That's the only model, so it's no model. Because I think, well, entrepreneurship is taking risks, right? And taking decisions that somebody else wouldn't take and be successful in that. So I think it's really, although that the left part might bring you money, stay on the right side. Because that is what you focus on, and that is what your dream was, actually. But that's taking a risk, because you don't know yet, you don't know what's in the future, you don't know yet whether the money is coming at the end. And on the other hand, if you really need the money, then you have to accept things like that. But then it's good to realize, okay, I accept it, but it's not the way I want to go, actually.
Yeah.
It's there's something else I want to go, and I just need this to get money to do the other thing.
Yeah.
And that is the other side. Yeah.
They also say that if you stick with your identity, then yeah, you can actually work even 80 hours a week, like
exactly.
40 hours for
yeah.
your job and 40 hours for on your dream.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
if you are lucky and persistent enough.
Yeah.
And, how do you see that, for example, this persistence, like keeping on going, whatever, is it a very crucial part? Or is there a point where you really have to give up?
There certainly will be a point that you really have to give up. No, but if you have your focus on a certain development,
yeah.
a certain product or service or whatsoever, it's difficult to say, but yes, you can divide from that. You can change another road or choose another road, or and as long as you believe in that, it's okay. Because I mean, companies like Unilever and the bigger companies also have their new ideas, and they try it. But there is a certain point that decide, okay, now it's costing too much money, and
yeah.
I can't go that way.
Yeah.
But also there is entrepreneurship to understand about when do I have to stop? Can I continue or and you can see here companies as well, startups, that at a certain moment they decide, okay, I'm going to take a job as well, because this might be the right way, but it's not never going to be the way I can earn a lot of money from, or I can have it's never going to be the way that I can live from it. I can earn enough money to live from it. So but it's there is no model that can help you to decide that. I mean, no, it is just experience and going as far as your wallet can afford.
What I also see as a controversy, that the startup world is also like you know, it comes with the VCs, angels and investors, and it's somehow projected to the world that it's quick, it's gonna happen. And it's actually, if you don't do any entrepreneurial thing, that you don't have a chance for sure.
That's right.
However, at the same time, more and more entrepreneurs say that it's a long-term game.
Yeah.
So how to find a balance between these two, like, oh, I'm gonna have a team and we're gonna have some nice product or a nice investor and we can go further. So that's the one idea, which is like maybe a short-term short-term scenario.
Yeah.
But you have the long-term vision, and maybe you work, or many product development goes on for years, or if you want to grow your personal brand, you cannot just pull it from the sky, hey, I'm an expert.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's also like a long term, at least a couple of years.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
The balance between these two is also
For sure. That's on one end. On the other end, it's all, you learn a lot from failing also with your company. Yeah, that is important also to know.
Yeah.
And once people that are entrepreneur, they don't, I can't say they don't mind, but they accept that there are also failures.
Yeah.
And then you can start another company because you are an entrepreneur. So that is also important to realize that not every startup can be successful. It could be, but the practice learns that not every startup is successful, and that's because of a lot of reasons, because the product is not right, the service is not right, or the people are not right, or the money isn't there, or it's the wrong product in the wrong time, and all those things can happen, but you can learn from those failures as well, that's also important to realize. Yeah.
So actually, that was one of the most important takeaway when I did my research, that in the US, the failing is good, so you can get almost immediately hired by another startup because you failed on your own cost, and for them it's just good. But back then, I mean, it was 4 years ago, four years ago when I did this research, but in the Netherlands it was still a kind of shameful thing to fail. So in that respect, has that any has changed it a bit
or
not?
I think so. It still is. It still is. Yeah. I think so. Although there is this guy, I can't remember his name. I can look it up. There is this guy that is writing books and telling a lot, giving presentations about his failures. And so he is indeed trying to change that.
Dutch guy.
Dutch guy.
Michael Pilarczyk, or not?
Sorry, Mike.
Michael Pilarczyk. He was the Radio 5 Dreyacht.
That's somebody else. Okay. I can't remember. No, it's not him. No. He has had failures and if you can realize that you can learn a lot from that, and indeed, like you say, in the USA that people are willing to hire you because you have got a lot of good experience how not to fail actually but it's still in the Netherlands. I think it's not so much accepted. Indeed, it's a shame. On the other hand, more and more people also see that you have good experience in how to be an entrepreneur and how to fail and why you failed and so on. So, but it's not like the US, I think, not yet.
I have one more general question. As an agriculture expert and also in sales and entrepreneurship, what do you miss from current agriculture and food practices, like when you go to the supermarket? Are you a little bit confused, or you have your own list of choice what you're gonna take? Or I mean, I'm asking it as how this sector behaves by serving the people, because sometimes it's very controversial with not healthy, many unhealthy foods, and what do you think is missing? If you could point it out more.
It's a difficult question. I think I always make my list at home, what I'm going to buy, and that's it. So I don't go to the supermarket to check and to see differences or whatsoever.
So it's good to have a standard list, shopping list?
I think so, because there's a lot of marketing going on in the shop as well, so you're invited to buy things that you actually don't want to buy or regret afterwards that you bought it, so that is a difference. And what I like is nowadays you have the Too Good To Go app, and then you can buy things that are on date, THT. How do you call it in English? The end
best
date.
Before.
Best before. And so I think that's a very good development, because otherwise that would have been thrown away. And I have recently I was in the supermarket and there's a lot of people coming there in the Jumbo to collect that bag with all those things which should be. We'd had the best before date already approaching, and those developments I think are very good. And although I guess there will be some unhealthy things in it as well, and but nevertheless it saves a lot in waste, I think.
So you see, the food waste is one of the biggest problems.
It definitely
and the rest is more personal choice and research, because we know what is not good for us, basically. Intellectually, we know.
That's a problem indeed. I don't blame everybody, but because I have the same. Some things are nice to drink or to eat, although you know it's not healthy or less healthy, so to say. I think. That will be very difficult to change it. And there is a change going on like that, like more healthy food and also using waste as a basic for new products and so on. So there's quite a lot of changing, but the most important part of there is the behavior of people to change that.
Yeah.
And that is a real difficult thing. Yeah,
because I also see that the supermarkets and the food suppliers, they have a very trustworthy relation. I mean, originally it should be a very trustworthy relationship, and sometimes it fails.
Definitely. I agree.
So how do you see the future from this in the next couple of years in Wageningen, and where will be the focus of the startups? Do you see any trends?
Well, the trend I see here, and I don't know why, but it's in the past there was a lot on plants and mushrooms and things like that, and nowadays you see more and more on technical things, technical aspects, I think. Mm. But is that a trend? I don't know. It's a small world here, of course. So I'm not sure if you can call that a trend.
Yeah, but somehow it reflects what is going on in the world. If we see it as a global hub.
Looking for a lot of technical solutions for the problems indeed. And if you say what problems do you see, then this morning I read in the paper about the UN report now about diversity, and it's terrible. It's really terrible.
Biodiversity.
And that is that can become a huge problem if we don't. We are not able to change that, and for sure it's going to be very difficult to change it, because there's so many people involved, so many organizations, companies, bad people involved that earn money from it, and so on.
And how are you informed about these alternative ways of agriculture? I would be very interested what your take on permaculture and regenerative agriculture, or these maybe the closed systems but nature-based but not monoculture, or urban gardening.
Well, I think it's not either one of them. It's the combination, and urban gardening, urban farming is an important thing as well, because it saves a lot of transport, and we have the technical skills to do those things, and we should do it then. But always much more than we did in the past, look at what's finally left over. What's the leftover at the end? Like now there is this idea of putting CO2 in the soil under the sea or something like that. Okay, we shouldn't produce the CO2, then there is no problem, you see. And how do you call it, waste plants. You can put it outside and make a mountain of it, but still waste. And so we're... how do you call it? We make our own nest dirty, so to say.
Yeah.
And so for all those things, also the urban farming, I think we should more and more check what's going to be left over at the end.
Yeah.
And can we solve that already or no? And that, I think, is very important. Otherwise, we leave all those things for the generations that still have to come. Yeah.
And I guess the entrepreneurial mindset is very important in this, because otherwise we can just blame the governments and blame the big multinationals.
Yeah.
And what can you do with blame?
Exactly.
I mean,
it'd
be nice to take some action.
And that is a lot of, let's say, responsibility to the younger people, the younger entrepreneurs indeed. To do it in a better way than the older ones did.
Cool. And you can help them.
I would be willing to. Would be great if I can do some. I can help them in some way or another.
Okay. So they can find you every Wednesday.
Every Wednesday afternoon, I'm here as one of the experts advising the people. That is, let's say, every not every, but
most of the
most
Wednesdays.
Of the Wednesdays.
Yeah.
and help, give them advice.
And people can also contact you per email
if they want to. Yeah, I'm on the website omeogroep.nl and so they can contact me, and I live very close to the startup, so if Wednesday is not possible for those people, I can come another time, and it's no problem for me.
Now startup is moving.
But it's only a couple of hundred meters, right? And so it's no problem for me.
Okay.
I'm walking distance, living on walking distance. So,
nice. Well, thank you for sharing your insights about what is
most
going
welcome.
On here.
Yeah.
And I hope that many people, including me, will go to you and get some more insights about business, human behavior, and entrepreneurship.
Yeah. So, most welcome. Yeah.
Say hi to the people.
Hi.
Ciao. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.